Hi everybody, Keith Shaw here for IDG Enterprise. Welcome to this Google Hangout where we are talking about the web in 2039. Joining me on this Hangout is Nathaniel Borenstein. He is the chief scientist at Mimecast and he's been involved in the internet for many, many years. So Nathaniel, welcome.
Just great. I'm glad to be here. Thanks.
So, you know, the internet happened about 25 years ago. In 1989, you know, I was still in college, just about to graduate from college. I don't even remember the internet being the internet until about 1994. So what were you doing in 1989 and, you know, where did it go from there?
Well, first of all, it wasn't quite the beginning of the internet. In 1989, I had been on the internet for 9 years. That was as it evolved from its precursor, which was ARPANET, into the internet that we know today. So it was sort of, there was a steady evolution. There was never one day when it changed from a research toy to this medium we know today. What was I doing on it? I had been working on email technology since shortly after I got on the net in 1980. And as of 1989, I was finishing up my work building an early multimedia system and moving to Bellcore, Bell Communications Research in New Jersey, where I did the work on standardizing it.
What were some of your thoughts about so in 1989 when kind of the World Wide Web started to appear, what were some of your early thoughts about this technology?
Well, it took me a while to get the web because I was so narrowly focused on email. In fact, the first time I heard of it was when somebody from the web project wrote and asked a question about whether they could use MIME for the web, which they ended up doing. So I heard about it through that sort of back doorway, but I very quickly became addicted to it like everybody else.
All right, and so over the past 25 years, obviously we've had things like, you know, Twitter, Facebook, video chats, smartphones, I mean, all sorts of things. So do you think that that over the past 25 years, you know, developers and those types of people have done a great job about kind of developing this World Wide Web, or, you know, is there so much more that we could be doing?
Well, I'd sort of say both. I mean, a lot of great things have been built, and a lot of people deserve credit for the role they've played in that. So I certainly wouldn't want to say, no, it was all a mistake. on the other hand, there's been a lot of variation in the value and the usability and the social benefits of things people have built with this technology. I think the open source movement has shown that you really can get more reliable code by letting lots of people look at it. And so the companies that don't do that, in my observation, have had less reliable code, which is pretty remarkable. As far as what people are going to build in the future, there's a couple of dangers there that are at the political level. That's what worries me. The fact that China has been so successful in subsetting the net for its citizens is, I fear, a pointer to the future in which you may not be able to get to some domain addresses. You may not be able to build new protocols on new port numbers, even though there's plenty of port numbers, because whoever's controlling it may not like the idea of your protocol. You know, that would affect the next BitTorrent, for example.
Right. It appears that, like, with the good, you get the bad. And so it feels like if we're going to try to predict, you know, what's going to happen in the next 25 years, I think you have to kind of assume that you're going to get some great stuff, but then you're also going to get some probably bad stuff, right?
Yeah, well, often the same thing is the great stuff and the bad stuff. And when you think about wearables, like Google Glass and beyond, it's easy to make a long list of all the things that will be great for it. Tourists will love it. You just look at something and find out about it. On the other hand, the privacy implications are overwhelming and, I fear, unavoidable. So it's going to bring both very good and very bad things.
Right. That's a great segue because this week Facebook just paid $2 billion for the Oculus Rift system. And, again, we can see the benefits of kind of virtual reality, especially in playing video games and things like that. But then, you know, now a company like Facebook, which is so big and which has run into some privacy discussions and issues, now all of a sudden they have control of something like that. You could also see, you know, some of the bad stuff. What's your thoughts on kind of Facebook and their purchase this week?
Well, I'm probably unusual in that I think it was very farsighted. And they have the money, they can afford to be farsighted, which most of us can't. But as those things mature, they're going to be extremely compelling, and not just for games. To give you an example, I've been using lately sometimes a telepresence robot. And in particular, this winter I had foot surgery and I couldn't go to the latest Internet Engineering Task Force meeting. Mm-hmm. So I went by telerobot. And what that meant was that I was sitting actually in this very room where I'm sitting now, and over in London at the conference, there was something that looked like an emaciated, starving Segway rolling around and talking to people. And there's still lots of room for improvement. It was barely usable, but even in that little bit of usability, you could see this enormous potential. And I was just looking through the narrow window of a video screen. If you match that up with the Oculus VR, you could more or less roll around the streets of London and sightsee and never have to get on an airplane.
Yeah, I've tried one of those telepresence robots as well, and I actually had a briefing with, so I was using the robot, but then the person I was talking to was also using a robot, so they were in two different places in a third place with the robots talking. It was very bizarre, but I can definitely see that, and then as we move towards kind of virtual reality too, you know, maybe having those virtual meetings where we're all just kind of not traveling at all.
Although I have to ask, when you had those two robots talking to each other, how was the audio quality?
The audio was actually pretty good. Yeah.
Really?
Again, I think the audio in something like this is pretty good. They're just utilizing the same types of technologies that we're using right now.
Well, I thought you had the two robots each with a speaker and microphone talking to each other. So it's not exactly the same thing as this. It's second generation.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I think that, you know, I could hear them just fine. They could hear me just fine. So as long as, again, the two people, the real people, could hear each other, then, you know, that was fine.
I just mentioned it because I found that although the robot is very useful, it's often more useful to have another channel for the audio that's dedicated. And this is an example, a very minor example, of where an open system might do better. There's no reason that robot couldn't use the audio from somebody who specialized in audio for years. They didn't have to build their own audio.
Right, and so, you know, as obviously those types of systems will get better over the next 25 years. Do you think that this trend of kind of telepresence robots will be there in 2039, or do you think that it'll go up and then other something else will be, you know, developed? And maybe we won't even need robots. We'll just do this all with like these giant helmets.
Well, I think they'll certainly be different looking than they are now. Miniaturization is going to continue to play a big part there. It may be that the telepresence robots of the future look less like a stripped-down Segway and more like a hummingbird as they fly around and see things. And so you wouldn't merely sightsee in London, you'd fly around and over London. I hope I live to see that. That will be really cool.
Oh, yeah, that would be cool. You know, or maybe it's a giant screen with someone's face on it, and that'll be flying around. That'll just be...
That's creepy, but we'll get used to it.
Yeah, well, I was wondering if those telepresence robots then became more humanoid, because we have seen humanoid robots that have been kind of developed. So instead of just a monitor on a Segway, do you get something where this robot is then actually walking around and you know, they would still have the face so that you know who you're talking to, but maybe a humanoid robot?
Well, that may well happen. I'm sure it will happen for purposes where a body is helpful. Like if you want to go to London and dig a hole in the ground, right? It's nice to have a body for that. On the other hand, having it look just like a robot may be helpful in avoiding the uncanny valley problem that they've had in animation, where an animation of a human that looks too close to real but not quite real just creeps people out. It would be easy to do that with these telepresence robots. And by the way, there's an interesting example of that just came out. They have a set of robots now that can be seen in video on the web pole dancing. And they're shaped like female humanoid robots.
Yeah, I saw that and I wrote about it for my blog on IT World. And yeah, the dancer part was actually pretty impressive, the fluid movements of the dancer.
Yeah, yeah.
And the artist had this like creepy mask that really freaked me out.
Yeah, it was impressive but creepy and certainly not erotic.
Well, I'm hoping that it wasn't meant to be an erotic dancer, just a regular, just kind of, you know, just to show that a dancer could, you know, a robot could move like left and right like that.
Okay, I hope that too.
Okay. All right, let's switch gears a little bit before I get in too much trouble here. When the World Wide Web was in, you know, when it first came to be known as the World Wide Web, about 20, 25 years ago, I don't think anybody really calls it the web anymore. We've heard things like you know, interweb, internet. I mean, these terms are all kind of used interchangeably. We're now hearing things like the cloud and the Internet of Things and all sorts of other terms. You know, I jokingly call it the interweb and the internetosphere and things like that. Can you make a random guess about maybe in 25 years what we'll be calling this thing?
Well, I suspect we'll be calling it several things, as we are now. You mentioned several currently used terms yourself.
Yeah.
The terms, I think, will remain fluid for as long as the internet remains fluid. And, you know, as it evolves, I mean, nobody would have called the whole internet the web before there was a web, but there was an internet. People also forget that the very term internet is a shortened form of the verb internetworking. Okay, because what it was referring to was the fact that separately administered networks would work together. They were internetworking. And what's funny about that is, from internetworking, we shortened it to internet. And by a few years ago, I heard a radio host on NPR reading a promo from some company that sponsored them that included the word internetworking. And they pronounced it internet working, because they had never heard the word internet working, so it must be just a missing space, right?
Exactly,
it just evolves and evolves. So there'll probably be new names for it. I suspect names like The Matrix, which comes largely from science fiction, will be replaced by names from other science fiction.
All right, let's segue into that stuff too. The science fiction has always been about kind of coming up with ideas that, you know, the future will bring this, this, and this. And sometimes they get it right, and sometimes they get it wrong. I mean, obviously the Star Trek communicator, you could say that turned into smartphones and things like that. But on the other hand, we still don't have flying cars. I'm still kind of bitter about that. So where do you know, what have you seen in science fiction? Most of the stuff I've seen or read has been kind of this virtual reality world, and now people are kind of bringing that up with this whole Facebook Oculus purchase. What kind of science fiction concepts do you think we might be seeing in the future?
Well, I've never found it a mistake to bet on Moore's Law. Moore's Law says that the density of transistors on a chip doubles every year and a half to 2 years. And if you just take that seriously, you can make a lot of predictions that are likely and sometimes scary. And in particular, we marvel today at how small our surveillance technology has gotten. We have these tiny little cameras, and they have Wi-Fi on them and so on. And isn't that amazing? Well, they could well become microscopic, or virtually so. And the implications of that are really striking. You will never know for sure that you're not on videotape, ever. Maybe if you're out in a national park or something, but even then, somebody may have planted something on your luggage or your backpack or whatever. So our notions of privacy have to change pretty radically in that world. On the other hand, similar robots will be sitting inside your body, monitoring your bloodstream, warning you of any problems that come up, and you know that's pretty welcome, even if it may be broadcast to the world by accident.
Okay, so there's a microscopic camera inside my body somewhere.
Well, inside your body, there might be a camera, but they need light for that. So we're into power problems there. You might be able to generate just through your own body's motion. But there will be sensors. That's the important part. They may not be sensing light. They may be sensing cholesterol or, you know, cancer cells.
Well, we're already seeing kind of the beginnings of that with health sensors and stuff. So, you know, you're wearing a Fitbit band or you're, you know, you've got a some sort of monitor that's monitoring kind of your health thing. So we're already kind of willing to put this on our bodies. What do you think it's going to be for us to put something inside our bodies? What's it going to take?
Well, these things always go generationally. So I think that there will be a young cohort that is saying, "Mom, why can't I have an implant? Why can't I have an implant?" And as that cohort ages, it will become largely the norm. Although we will also undoubtedly have Luddite communities hiding in the wilderness and trying to believe they don't have cameras hidden out there somewhere.
Do you think that a lot of these initial kind of sensors will be just to use to monitor someone's health, or do you think that they'll be going in to kind of like cure someone? I'm thinking of like the old Fantastic Voyage story in the movie where they miniaturized the little sub and that went around floating into the person's bloodstream.
I think that's feasible. I think monitoring will come first simply because it's easier. You know, you're just getting some kind of sensor readings and transmitting them out. But the next step would be sort of a slow, the ultimate time-release drug, right? You could actually control down to the grain how much you're releasing, presumably. So I think it'll all happen, but just reporting information via sensors is the easiest thing to do. We can do some of that today.
And of course, that'll have a bad side too, because if those sensors get hacked, or if the government decides that they need to start monitoring everybody's movements, even through where your body is, I mean, that's really troubling too, right?
Oh yeah. Well, back about 10, 15 years ago, right after the 2000 election, I think, I started making jokes about Dick Cheney's pacemaker, because he did have a pacemaker with wireless access, and I would often, in conversations like this one, refer to the possibility of a hacker getting in and, you know, giving him his heart new commands. Well, since the Bush-Cheney administration, or the Cheney-Bush administration, ended, some revelations have come out, and one of them was that he had a whole security team around the protection of his pacemaker. So, you know, I wasn't making things up when I was making that up.
Yeah, you know, it sometimes feels like technology advances so quickly that, the rest of us need time to kind of catch up, and we don't even realize kind of like a lot of these implications until it's almost too late. Do you think we're getting better at realizing kind of these advancements?
I think there's always been a mix, and I'll just give you two examples from my own experience. I worked on mail for all those years, email, and early on people would say, why do you want to put pictures and things in email? And what I always said was, someday I'm going to have grandchildren, and I want to get pictures of them by email. And I think that if we do this work, it'll be ready by the time my grandkids came along. And that was true. Okay, so I did get my first pictures of my grandkids via email, very satisfying. On the other hand, I also studied for just a little while speech recognition, and I got out of that business in the early 80s after just putting a toe in the water, because I was absolutely convinced it would never come to fruition in my lifetime. And, you know, that one was pretty wrong. In that case, I didn't properly count on the fact that raw computational power without understanding would be enough. You know, so some things are easier to foresee than others.
Yeah. So where do you think communication will, kind of evolve in the next 25 years? Obviously, face-to-face conversation is never going to go away. I think we'll, because obviously people won't want it to go away.
Pardon me for just a second.
Yeah.
Is this face-to-face conversation right now that we're having?
That's a really good question. I mean, I'm assuming it is.
Okay. I just want to know what you meant.
Well, all right. It's face-to-face in the fact that I can see you, you can see me, and we're having a conversation. Now, if I, and I know that this is really me, I think. but if I change to an avatar and all of a sudden now I look like a 6-foot rabbit, does that become face-to-face communication?
Well, see, that's why I asked, is that the only easy definition I know of face-to-face is when you're in the same room and breathing the same air and there's no electronics mediating you, because then from there it's a slippery slope. But I think what you were probably trying to say was more like something like audio-visual synchronous communication. We see and hear each other, and it's real time.
All right. How about human-to-human touch interface communication?
That sounds like sex to me.
I know. Oh, boy. Okay, so...
It could just be a good kind of touching.
Go ahead.
I just said it could be a good kind of touching.
All right. Beyond that, where does kind of communication go in the next 25 years? Again, obviously, it feels like this will get better, so that you'll be able to, the resolution and the bandwidth and all that kind of stuff will get better on video chats. Mm-hmm. And then there's the possibility of virtual communications through virtual reality or what other kind of headsets are developed. Is there anything else that you're seeing for people to kind of, communicate with each other or collaborate with each other, that kind of stuff?
Well, I think technologists try to put their efforts into places where there's a real need. So if you look at today's communication and say what it is that's bad about it, you've got a good head start on predicting the next thing. Not always, because some things like ending spam are pretty much impossible. But in the case of individuals, I think there's a clear need for better management of email threads. And several people are trying to do that nowadays, and nobody seems to have gotten it quite perfect. But enough people are trying because there's a general need for saying these 13 things are in one thread and I want to see them as a whole and so on. So that's a sort of a consumer need that gives you a predictable change just in the next couple of years. On the business side, there's similar things. My company, Mimecast, is in the business of providing all the auxiliary services to email that businesses need, and there's quite a long list of them, which I won't bother you with now, but we've passed a tipping point where it makes any sense to do that stuff in-house. So we're trying to meet that need of companies to stop having to worry about all these things. When you look further ahead, you won't see any needs. That is, nobody today perceives a need for something that we will have in 25 years. That's probably an overstatement, nothing. But in general, it's too far removed from the needs. So you have to try to get there by projecting new capabilities of technology more than anything else.
Yeah, so what I always find amazing are all these companies that come out and try to say that we're going to solve the email problem, or because I think the biggest pain point for a lot of people in business now is that they're getting so many emails and they're spending so much time just kind of going through the email that email becomes tedious. But everything that I've seen, you know, whether it's a collaboration thing or a real-time presence thing or, you know, unified communications, all this other stuff never really seems to want me to get rid of my email. And it seems like they're just piling on more forms of communication. And because I still don't want to give up that email because of the fact that I can send an email, it doesn't have to be immediate. I'm not going to replace email with video chats all the time, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess my question, I don't even know if I have a question, but you know, is email still going to exist in 2039? I guess.
Well, I think it will if you define email correctly. Just like we were talking about defining face-to-face correctly. If you define it as asynchronous communication, asynchronous messaging,
right.
It will definitely continue to exist. Now, if you look back to the 1980s, there were a dozen different kinds of email on different kinds of networks that didn't talk to each other. And today there's only one, and that went through a process of sort of standardizing and coalescing. And the point is that what we ended up with, and we're still calling email now, is kind of different from what we were calling email then. And it's actually kind of different from what we were calling email 10 years ago. So I think it'll evolve. I also think it's important to point out, when people talk about being overwhelmed by email, and I'm overwhelmed by email, that most of the things that you do with email that you think are worthwhile are things that prior to email you would have done with paper, and it probably would have taken even more time, or that you wouldn't have been able to do before. So we complain about a tool taking up our time, but we're the ones who choose to spend that much time on it, and at some level it must be because it's useful and it's making us more efficient. Now, I qualified that by saying the email that you think is worthwhile. We still haven't finished the job of making sure that's all you get.
Right.
Part of that is technical. As I said, spam is fundamentally unsolvable. But some of that is social too. Developing better mores, at least within corporations, customs about what you do and don't do by email, and better mechanisms for being selective about what you see.
All right, we're going to kind of wrap it up now. Nathaniel, give me one thing that won't exist in 2039.
The easy answer has to do with people older than me, but I'm not going to say that.
Let's assume that both you and I are still here.
Okay, place a little bet on it. I would say large software companies will either have ceased to exist or will have radically restructured themselves to look more like the grassroots that are active in open source.
Okay. So large companies are going to. I'm going to say flying cars. We still won't have them.
Actually, you know, we do sort of have them now. There's a couple companies that are either selling them or say they're selling them later this year, but you and I can't afford them. They are fabulously expensive, and they burn quantities of fuel that are ridiculous, and you'll probably just crash it anyway.
Well, you know, it's funny because with all of these new ways of communicating and, you know, and with robots and things like that, maybe we'll just have robots driving the cars. I could actually see us doing a lot of self-driving cars. But I think that our travel in general will just kind of wane as well. I don't think we're all just going to kind of be in one location for the most part.
I think the better the things like the telepresence robots get, the closer we'll get to that. There are some people I think who are going to be real holdouts for physical presence. It's easier to say, oh, all right, I'll use email instead of my fountain pen, than it is to say, oh, I'll stay here forever rather than ever see Paris. that's a tougher sell.
Yeah, as much as I would love to enjoy kind of visiting a virtual Paris or a virtual London, I'm still going to want to probably go and see it for myself. And I mean, maybe that'll be a generational thing too. And I'm going to insist that my kids come and visit me. So they don't have to travel to come see me in 25 years.
I think that's a good plan. I have a place that is very kid-friendly, and that's how I plan to lure my grandkids up here.
I will try to remember that as well. All right, Nathaniel Borenstein, thank you very much for joining us on the show today.
It's been a pleasure.
All right, just a quick plug. Where can people go to learn more about Mimecast?
Mimecast.com.
There you go. All right. Thanks, everybody, for watching, and we'll see you next time on one of our Google Hangouts. Bye.
Bye.